everybody, and welcome to this all-age service as we come to Christmas in a week's time. Just a couple of very quick announcements. You're well used to me going on forever, but not today.
I'll grab a seat then. So.
You can take a seat. Tonight our carol service is at 6 o'clock, so you'll all be welcome back again for our lessons in carol service. And on Christmas morning, we'll be here at 10:30. Last year, we tried to do the service on Zoom, and we're planning to try and do that again this year so that some of the households who might make it a bit more difficult to get out on Christmas morning, like the ones who travel from Five Mile Town every week. So we'll put that on Zoom, 10:30 on Christmas morning. There are envelopes that have been distributed to everybody, hopefully by the elders for the World Development Appeal. So can we get those back in over the next couple of weeks, please? And Dave would like to speak with the elders for 5 or 10 minutes after the service, probably down in the Stevenson room. So other than that, it's over to the new boss.
Jarvis is still the boss. That's when I want to speak to the elders, sort out who's in charge. So they're like, grace and peace to all of you this morning. It's really good to have you here. If you're visiting, or if this is maybe your first Sunday here or first Sunday here in a while, I'm with you, as this is my first Sunday here as the new minister. So we'll get through this together. And I'll say a little bit more about that towards the end of the service. But a quick reminder, this is everybody together. This is all age family worship, from the youngest to the oldest. And if we can't cope with a little bit of noise in a Christmas service where we think about a baby being born, okay, we're in trouble. I'm sure despite the carols, what they say, the little baby Jesus probably cried. So if you're with little ones, it's grand, okay? Don't worry about the noise. We're glad to have everyone here. Hopefully as you came in, if you're younger, you would have got one of the little handouts. Just keep you things to do during the service, and a few little points you can take from what I say later on as well. So I want us first of all to remind each other of something, that this is what Christmas is all about. The fact that God has done a marvelous thing. So we're going to do that by reading something together. It's a little bit of a psalm. And the psalms are really just a collection of songs and poems. And I'm going to read some words on the screen, and then you're going to say something back to me. You're going to say this on the screen back to me. We're just going to repeat it a number of times. So let's go for a practice, okay? He has... Cheapers. Come on. You're here on time, but come on, you need to be here awake on time, okay? Let's go after three. 1, 2, 3. He has... There we go. Dead simple. Okay. And when we do that, then Julie and the guys are going to lead us in worship. So let's stand together. And just a reminder that unless you're exempt, you're encouraged to keep your masks on, okay? So, sing to the Lord a new song.
He has done marvelous things.
He has remembered his love and his faithfulness to his people.
He has done marvelous things.
All the ends of the earth have seen the salvation of our God. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Burst into jubilant song with music.
He has
Julie, let's burst into song.
Good morning, everybody. So as was said at the start, there are some musical instruments up the front for young and old, and we're going to sing Away in a Manger with a chorus, It's Christmas. So whenever it gets to the chorus, the bells are all ringing, and I feel like shouting joy to the world. So... And it tells us to make a joyful noise. So
you mute me, James?
Let's make a joyful noise and let's sing Away in a Manger, It's Christmas.
Let's
Super. One of the great things we get to do when we come to church is come to God and talk to Him. And we thank Him for all the good things He's given to us. We say sorry for the wrong things that we do. That's what Christmas is all about. Jesus comes to us so we can come close to God because He forgives us. And even though we do things that are against the way God wants us to live, God is for us because He wants to forgive us. So we're going to do that now. We're going to use our hands to help us to do that. So permission to keep your eyes open during this prayer, okay? And keep your eyes open. You're going to watch what I do. You're going to use your hands. Feel free. No pressure if you do want to do it, okay? So don't feel under any pressure. But if you want to engage, sometimes doing something physical helps us do something spiritual. So I'm going to encourage you to do that. So let's pray. So the first thing we're going to do, okay, is going to raise our hands if you want to. There we go. And we're going to pray. So God, You are great and You are good and You are full of unfailing love and generous grace. You don't give us what we deserve, but You forgive us. So hear our confessions, okay? Now, next one, you're going to make a fist. Okay, what do you do with your fists? Anyone? Fight, okay? So we're going to say sorry, okay? So God, we're sorry for the times we've got angry with other people and we fought and we haven't forgiven. And forgive us for that. Okay, now, you're going to point away from yourself at other people with your index finger, okay? Okay, so let's pray. We're sorry for the times we've blamed other people and we've seen things wrong in other people without realizing how much also is wrong in us. Now, I'm going to close up your hand, put it into your chest as if you're holding something really, really tight into your chest, okay? So God, we're sorry for the things we've been selfish and kept things to ourselves. Sorry for the times we've not been prepared to give to others because we've wanted to keep things for ourselves. Now, put your hand over your mouth. I can't, because you can't hear me. Okay, God, we're sorry for the foolish and hurtful words that we've said to other people who we've hurt and offended. God, forgive us for our words. Now, put your hand over your eyes. This is the one that you're closing your eyes in, okay? I can't do it because I can't read them. So, God, we're sorry that we have deliberately chosen not to see good things in other people, or good things that we could have done to help other people. Now, you can't put both hands over your ear because you would hear me, but put one hand over your ear. So we're talking about our hearing. Okay, God, so we're sorry when we haven't listened to the cries of other people for help or for justice, those who are poor, those who are struggling, and those who are needy. We're sorry that we've closed our ears and not listened to Your call to help others. Now, you're going to put your hands out, your palms open. Okay, as if you're carrying something really heavy, okay? So Jesus says, if you're tired from carrying heavy burdens, come to me and I will give you rest. So God, we bring everything that we carry, all of our struggles, all of our problems, all of our sins, our failure to love other people. And we thank you for this marvelous thing about Christmas, that you were born into the world, that you live for us, and that you die for us so that you might take our burdens and our sin and our struggles, and we might live our lives following you in the power of your Holy Spirit. Amen. Now, I want you to keep your hand open. So quite often when you do a prayer of, we call it prayer of confession, confess to God, and sometimes we kind of wonder, does God actually really forgive us? I mean, there's lots of wrong things I do. The Bible's full of verses that remind us that God forgives us. So what I want you to do, just as I read this little verse, you're just going to trace a little cross shape in your hand, just to remind you that it's a cross that helps to forgive us, okay? But if we confess our sins, so if we say sorry, he will forgive our sins. We can trust God, he does what is right, and he will make us clean from all the wrongs that we have done. So if you've joined in that prayer, God's forgiven you. End of story. It's done, it's gone. Okay, now, before we sing again, we're going to play a little game. Does anyone play games at Christmas in the house? Anyone fight after the games at Christmas in their house? Yeah, there's a few nods, yeah. People fall out. Now, opportunities for families to get together and then fall out. So I thought we would play a game. Now, as long as we promise we're not going to fall out. Yeah? Okay. Now, you've heard of rock, paper, scissors? Has everyone heard of rock, paper, scissors? We're going to play a slightly Christmas version of it. So we've got socks, wrapping paper, and scissors, okay? So the rules of this, so this is socks, okay? So hold your nose. Everyone hold your nose? Yeah. Okay. Wrapping paper is like that, okay, and scissors are like that, okay. Now, here's the rules. Now, I always forget these rules, but we're going to remember them, okay. So socks, okay, they beat scissors, okay. Wrapping paper beat socks. Try to remember this, okay. And scissors beat wrapping paper, okay. Now, we're going to play this all together. It's really simple. So you're all going to stand up, okay. You're all going to stand up, okay. And everyone's playing against me, okay? So if you beat me, you stay standing. If I beat you, you sit down, and we'll see who's the winner at the end, okay? And if you win, the prize is socks, wrapping paper, and scissors, all right? Which socks are these? Mike, are these your socks from football? I'll buy you a new pair of socks, okay? So socks, wrapping paper, or scissors, okay? That's simple, okay? So I gotta do one, two, three, we'll go, okay? Ah, you've started already. Gail's going scissors, so if anyone wants to beat Gail. Okay. So one, two, three. Okay, so wrapping paper beats socks. If you wear socks, you have to sit down. Sorry. Okay. One, two, three. He's just copying me. Okay. If you're wrapping paper, you have to sit down. Okay. One, two, three. Oh, if you're wrapping paper, actually, there you go. If you're wrapping paper, stay. Okay, one, two, three. Okay, if you are, what the socks beat? Scissors, if you're scissors, you have to sit down. Who's still, still going, okay. One, two, three. You've seen your copy of me. One, two, three. Wrapping paper, sit down. Let me, oh, there we go. I'm getting rid of people gradually, so we're, one, two, three. I think you're all just copying me, Caesar. Okay, everyone close your eyes. Now, this is up, close your eyes, okay. Okay, one, two, three. Scissors, you're beat, you have to sit down. One, two, three. What am I, wrapping paper beats socks. One, two, three. Wrapping paper beats socks down. Okay, there's a family feud going on here in the middle. Okay, one, two, three. Oh, geez, you sure? I bet you're copying me, not so you are. Okay, one, two, three. Okay. Right. Last one, and then I'll have to get you all socks. One, two, three. Right, you three winners there, okay. You can't defy. Well done. To get three pairs of socks, okay. Listen, just a little bit of fun. And I won't accuse anyone of cheating in this church, because we're not going to fall out of this, okay. Now, Nativity is all about a story, okay. We're going to read from the Bible in a little bit, but I want us to tell the story of the Nativity together, okay. And do a little bit of... Because social distancing, we can't really have everyone at the front doing it, so we're going to do a little bit of an action and a follow-along story. So there's going to be some things that you're going to do just while you're sitting there, and there's going to be some things you're going to read along on the screen. Nativity is a story of the marvelous thing that God has done, what Christmas is all about. It's going to be everybody. We're going to help. So some actions. So the first slide, you're going to see some words, okay? So if you hear the word well, good, okay, in the story, you're going to just put thumbs up like that. Okay, go for it. Thumbs up. You're going to work out this morning, okay? If you hear the word shepherds, you're going to make curly horns and go, ba. Good sheep. If wise men, okay, you're going to stroke your chin and go, Okay. If it's Mary, you're going to put your hands up and shout, Mommy. It has to be high-pitched, okay? Mommy. And if it's Joseph, Daddy. Oh, there we go. Julie's on bass later on, so she is. And if it's the angels, okay, put your like heel over your head and you go, oh, like a choir of angels here this morning, okay? And then some little things will appear on the screen sometimes for you to read, and you're just going to read along. So you're going to tell the story together. You pick it up as you go along, okay? So our story starts a really, really, really long time ago. It was a time before toys and turkeys and trees. Our story starts before humans like you and like me. Our story begins so long ago, it was even before Jarvis was born. A time before everything, God made the world, and it was well good. There we go. But the humans he made, like you and like me, said mean things and were really quite nasty. In fact, the humans didn't listen to God. They'd hurt each other and wouldn't make amends, so God and humans could no longer be friends. But to be friends again, God had a marvelous plan, and his plan was to send a very special young man. So many years later, there's a young lady called Mary. There we go. From the Bible, I mean, not the baker called Barry. This one day, or maybe even one night, an angel suddenly appeared and gave Mary quite a fright. Well, you need to get quicker. And the angel said, we're going to read this together. Oh, sorry. Yes, sorry. Sorry, my bad. Yes, the one in the sky said, okay, we're going to read this together. I bring good news. It's well, good, honest. There'll be a baby born just as God promised. So Mary was going to have a baby just as God promised, and the baby would be called Jesus. There was a man called Joseph, and he was going to marry Mary, but Joseph noticed she had a bit of a belly. He saw her big belly bump and wondered how it got there, so he scratched his head and twizzled his hair. But one night when Joseph was sleeping, an angel came to visit with a message that Mary would give birth through God's Spirit. And the angel, didn't get caught out of time, said, I bring good news, it's well, good, honest, there'll be a baby born just as God promised. So Mary and Joseph, both of them, set off together on a journey all the way to Bethlehem. And when they arrived at Bethlehem, Mary was ready to give birth to the baby who'll be king, but in none of the guest rooms any rooms to sleep in. Don't be afraid. Don't get uptight. Relax, take a breather. You'll be all right. So they managed to find at least somewhere to stay, in a room with family and animals and even some hay. They went into the place, and that's where they laid. And then Jesus was born with straw for a bed. Now in a field nearby, there were some shepherds. And they were just busy minding their business. Maybe cleaning their shoes, maybe trying to scrape off the smelly sheep poos. But all of a sudden, something really weird happened. Out of nowhere, an angel appeared. Don't be afraid, that's what I say. Say hi to the baby in a manger full of hay. And then as the angel said that, something even weirder occurred. Suddenly loads of angels. And here's what they heard. I bring good news, it's well, good, honest. There'll be a baby born just as God promised. So the shepherds, having listened to what the angels said, hurried off to Bethlehem to find the straw bed. And they found it there just as they said. So teeny and tiny Jesus, the babe. And there were also some wise men, who a star they had pondered and followed it for miles from way over yonder. And they didn't use Google Maps or sat-nav, they followed a star. They went to King Herod, and they asked where the baby Jesus was, as they'd seen his star. So Herod sent the wise men to Bethlehem, which wasn't all that far. And the wise men found Jesus next to animals with fur, and they brought him some gold and frankincense and myrrh, and the wise men bowed down and worshipped him there. And the wise men remembered King Herod wanted them to report back to him, but Herod wasn't very nice, so they were warned in a dream not to go back to him. Don't be afraid, here's what I say. Just don't visit Herod, go home another way. Herod searched high and Herod searched low, but where was Jesus? He just didn't know. For an angel appeared to Mary and Joseph, we're almost there, to warn them to flee, to hide from Herod in a different country. Don't be afraid, don't get uptight, relax, take a breather, you'll be all right. So they lived as refugees until Herod was gone, and then they were no longer afraid. They traveled back home, and that's where they stayed. And do you remember when we were nasty to each other and we wouldn't make amends, when God and humans could no longer be friends? But then God had a marvelous plan to make all the amends. Well, Jesus the baby became Jesus the man, and Jesus is God's marvelous rescue plan. We're going to sing of those angels. Oh, come on. No, it's the guys lead us in worship.
Okay, so we're going to stand, we're going to sing Angels from the Realms of Glory, and there's a little chorus in that, and you can play your bells and instruments if you like again. So let's stand and worship God with this song.
Bit of that story from the Bible, and there's a few folks who are going to help us read it, and they're going to come to the front, and as they come, I'm just going to pray before we read. So let's pray together. God, we thank you at Christmas for the gift of Jesus, and we thank you for the gift of forgiveness, and we thank you now for the gift of your word, the Bible. This is you speaking to us one-to-one, so as it's read, as we hear it, we hear your words. So help us to hear the story, help us to wonder at it, help us to be encouraged by it, help us to be changed by it, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Come on in. And in the same region, there were shepherds out in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone round them, and they were filled with great fear. And the angel said to them,
"Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Saviour, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger."
And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying,
"Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased."
When the angels went away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another,
"Let us go over to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has known to us."
And they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in a manger. And when they saw it, they made known the saying that had been told them concerning this child. And all who heard it wondered at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured up all these things, pondering them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen as it had been told them.
Thank you, guys. Thanks, Rosemary and Olivia and Elijah. So I'm going to just think about that passage for a little bit. If you're younger, you have this little activity sheet. There's a word search in the back. There are some points where you can actually, if you listen really carefully, you can hear some of the points I'm going to make. I'll try and make those nice and clear for you. There's a space you could draw the best ever present you got for Christmas, or you could draw the best present you're going to get me for Christmas. That's the other thing as well, okay? And you can show me some of those afterwards, okay? Now, who has already been eating too much before Christmas? Julia, thank you. Correa, okay. We've got loads of sweets. Been really kind. People have been really kind in our house, and we've had loads of sweets. We had this box of Tunnock's marshmallows bought for us probably just a week and a half ago. Now, how many's in that? Somebody knows that too quickly, so they do. There's 36. Well, there's one tray's empty. There's another tray's empty. There's four left in that. Now, the problem is, my dad always got these for Christmas, and one Christmas, we got everybody to get my dad them. So he ended up with about 400 Tunnock's tea cakes, and he hid them all under his bed, so he did. But this box is almost empty. Now, I'm not sure if these little things are getting smaller or my mouth is getting bigger, because these fit really nicely. In one go. Rodney, can you cut this bit out? Which means you can eat one or two or three at a time. Not very quickly. We eat too much at Christmas, lots of the time. And then after Christmas, we want to make sure that we get rid of all the stuff that we eat. So either go to the gym or get into the exercise. Burn off what we want to burn off. And the other thing we do is we then want to try and build up muscle in place of it. Now you can see that I'm obviously a man that builds up a lot of muscle. Not. But at the gym, when you go to the gym, you do lots of what's called reps. You do the same thing again and again. Okay, anyone go to the gym? I'm sure you all do. No. I feel even more at home. That's great. You go to the gym and you do reps. You do the same exercise again and again to build certain muscles. Now, I'm not going to do this, but would anyone, any of the kids, do you like to demonstrate how to do a press-up in the aisle? Anyone do a press-up? No? Colin's going. You do press-ups, you do again and again, and you build up these muscles in your arms, okay? You do repeat stuff. Now, at Christmas, we also do reps. We do the same thing because we read the same story every year. Okay? Some people think the same story every year, but we do it because we want to exercise not our physical muscles, but our spiritual muscles. We want to learn and grow as followers of Jesus. You've done it in school probably this week. We'll do it this morning. We'll read it again tonight. You might read it at home again and again. We're telling the same story about Jesus coming. But it's all about building up these muscles of being followers of Jesus. And this morning, I want us to work on three muscles, okay? Three muscles this morning. And if you listen really carefully, you'll get the three G's in there, but I'll say them again, so don't worry. We're going to work on our gladness muscles, so about being joyful. We're going to work on our gratitude muscles, being thankful, and we're going to work on our going muscles, being followers of Jesus in the world outside of church. So what's the first muscle we're working on? It's going to be gladness. We're going to think about being joyful. Now, let me see you work on your gladness muscles. There's lots of muscles in your face. Let me see your biggest smile. It's massive. That's really good. Yeah, biggest smile. Oh, sorry. I'll trust that you're all smiling by masks. So well, okay, but kids, those are impressive smiles, okay? But it's more, gladness is more than just a smile on the outside. Gladness is about joy on the inside, a smile that comes from the inside. So imagine being one of the shepherds in the field. You're minding your own business, you're minding your sheep, and suddenly an angel appears in the sky. And what does the angel say? They say, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people." Good news. We need good news. There's lots of bad news. There's even more bad news at the minute in terms of what we're thinking about in terms of COVID. And maybe you don't see it so much as a younger person. But which slightly older person or teenager or adult maybe isn't weary and worn out by all the bad news at the minute? Fed up, done in, had enough up to the back teeth. COVID and conflict, deaths and disasters. But here the angel announces good news, which will do what? It will bring joy, and not just joy, but great joy to all people. And it's quite the claim. We have politicians and scientists who can't give us any good news about one virus, yet here we have an angel claiming to have good news of great joy for all people at all times in all circumstances. And what is the cause of the great joy? For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. This cause of this great joy is a gift. So Christmas, you get gifts, okay? These presents. This is a gift that God gives to us, which will bring us great joy. We all love opening presents, and we get great joy from the Christmas. So what's the gift so we can work on our gladness muscles? Well, the gift is this baby born in Bethlehem. That's the city of David. Okay, David was the king of Israel. Everyone thought everything was going to be okay with David in charge, but it didn't quite work out like that. So God sends a better king, and this baby is the better king. He's more than a king. He's a savior. And that means, and this is where the repetition kicks in, because you might think, I knew this. And I know lots of us knew this already, but repetition builds muscles, so work your gladness muscles. It means the baby saves us, which means we need saved. And the big story of the Bible is of people cut off from God, who is the source of all light and life and love. It's a little phrase from a guy called Glenn Scrivener. And we live in darkness, disconnection, and death. It's like being stuck in a pit. So imagine being stuck in a pit all your life, and you can't get out of it, no matter how hard you try, no matter how much you try and climb up the side, you can't get out of this pit. Quite often it's a pit we dig for ourselves. We live against God and the good life he calls us to. And the Bible calls this really big and difficult thing by a really small and simple little word, which is sin. And that sin keeps us stuck in the pit forever. But Jesus comes as this gift from God, as the rescuer, the savior that lifts us out of the pit. Takes all of the sin, buries it in the pit, dies in our place in the darkness and suffers disconnection from God so that we can all, from the youngest to the oldest, have light and life and love. The light and life and love that Jesus shares with God forever and that he gives to us to share with God forever. He saves us for God. And that's something to be glad about. It says he's also Christ, and that's not his surname. He's not Mr. Jesus Christ. That's not a surname. It's a title. It means chosen one or anointed one. It tells us that Jesus didn't just stumble across us one day in a pit and go, oh, there's some people in a pit. I better help them. No, this is all part of a plan from way, way back, the start of you can't even do the start of eternity, but from all eternity, God has had a plan to save people. So it wasn't an accident, but the actual reason Jesus came to earth. It wasn't that he came to earth, thought, I'll go and visit, and then finds people in a mess. He came because people were in a mess, and he came to rescue us. He was sent by God in order that we could be saved by God. So that's how much God cares and loves each one of us, that he would actually send Jesus on purpose to save us from the pits that we were in all our mess, in the depths, no matter how deep you think your pit is, God sent Jesus on purpose as a gift to save you. That should make us glad. It also says he's Lord. Lord reminds us that Jesus isn't just a man, he's God as well. This little baby, flesh and blood, grows up not only to die for us, he's resurrected, comes back to life, and goes back to be with God. So right now, Jesus is with God in heaven. He rules over everything, the entirety of creation. And one day he comes back, and we'll think about this more tonight. But he's coming back to empty the world of all the sad things and all the bad things. He's going to fill in all the pits. He's going to empty the world of everything that hurts us and harms us. And that makes us glad, even in the midst of darkness and hurts. And he invites us now to follow him as Jesus, as Lord, to say we're going to live our lives the way you call us to. He promises in John 10 that in doing that, we can have life to the full. We're worried about what we're going to lose out if we can't go out to here, or can't meet with our family here and there and do whatever during COVID. But Jesus says, actually, we can have life to the full in him, which gives us gladness and joy, even when life is really difficult. So, gladness muscles. Let's see your smiles again. Biggest smiles. Come on. Yeah, there you go. Spot on. Right at the front. Super. Okay, next muscle is our gratitude muscle. Okay, done this already. So you put your hands up in the air and just go like that. Jazz hands, kind of. Okay. You don't need to do it for the whole thing. You can take them down now. Okay. Just being thankful. Hands lifted to God to thank God for what he does for us. Okay. If there's a gift, then there must be a giver. Okay. So if I have this gift to give to someone, it's not just the gift, it's the giver. Okay. Somebody gives a gift. Where do the gifts come from? Now, the thing we start to worry about at this time of this year is whether we've been on the good list or the naughty list. And now we have a sneaky little elf that hides in lots of our houses who keeps an eye on us to see if we've been good or bad. But the thing is, when it comes to other presents from family and from friends, it doesn't work like this. So we'll get presents for our kids, and we know they're not always good. Sometimes they do wrong things. Now, they'll say, well, sometimes mommy and daddy do wrong things as well. So it balances out. But we'll get them despite behavior sometimes. Maybe my kids will get me a present. Good 5 days, by the way, guys, okay? But they know I'm far from perfect. But they'll still get me a present. And that's the story of the Bible, the gift that God gives, Jesus. Well, we don't deserve it. And yes, I know we know this. Here's the repetition thing again. Because it's tempting to think about all the good things we've done and how many times we've been to church and how much money we've given. I'm okay this year. You might think there was a good list and another list. Well, we probably have been on the good. Certainly compared to that person. I'm not pointing at anyone over there by any point up there. Certainly compared to that person or these people. So we need to constantly remember that God gives us what we don't deserve. We call this grace. We need to keep pumping away at grace to build up our gratitude muscles, our thankfulness. And not only has God gracious given us what we don't deserve, he is generous. He gives us what we could never afford. The gift of life and light and love is absolutely priceless. Every year there's presents that are so popular, you can't get them for love nor money. Every year there's presents you'd love to give or get for someone, but you just can't afford, they're out of your budget. But God offers us, gives us the most priceless of gifts, his own son. And when you get a present this year, you'll be glad to get it. But you'll be glad about the person who gave it to you. You'll be thankful to them and thankful for them. So we're called at Christmas to work our gratitude muscles and be thankful to God, his grace, his generosity. And that's why we sing and worship. That's part of our thankfulness. That's why the host of angels appeared after the announcement of the good news and they shout glory to God in the highest. So not only is this gift here, it's about glory to God. It's about because he's the good giver. So we lift our hands in the air and we say glory to God in the highest. Gratitude muscles being worked. Our gladness muscles being worked at the same time. Last set of muscles. Okay, let me see you do peace sign. Okay, careful which way you do it around, okay? Don't want to get offended at the front, okay? I want to work our going muscles, being a follower of Jesus. So if there's a gift and a giver, then there must be the person who has given the gift. So there's a gift, there's a giver, and then I get this present. Now let me see what the present is. You might want to play this game. It's called Poo Bingo. It's really popular in our house, so it is, okay? It's a really fun present. If you're looking at good present games for kids, this is a good one, okay? But what do you do with a present? Do you stick it back in the bag? Anyone just stick their presents back in the bag this year? No, we take it and we use it and we play with it. If there's a gift and a giver, there's the people that are given something and then they're called to use it. So the angels finish off by saying, glory to God in the highest, on earth peace ought to those on whom his favor rests. God's favor rests on those who open their hands with joy, receive his gift of thankfulness. So the invitation to all of us, if we haven't received it already, is to receive the gift of Jesus. That's the call, a really simple one. To be rescued from the pit of sin, be given life and light and love. And if you'd like to talk about that, I'm here for a good while, so I'd love to talk with you about it. And in doing so, we get peace. We get peace in our lives, which is the most stunning gift that we can be given. The world is devoid of peace at the minute, full of anxiety and fear and worry and uncertainty. But we get peace. And then we have peace with God. When we're stuck in the pit, we're living against God. We're kind of shaking our fist at him. We've turned our back on him. But when we're saved out of the pit, we're reconnected with him in peace, not just as an acquaintance, not just as a friend, but as part of his family, as a son or a daughter. He gives his son in order for us to become sons and daughters. And when you're in this family, you're there forever. You'll be cared for and loved and have life forever. Nothing can shake you. Nothing can take you, which gives us this incredible sense of peace as we go and live our lives, because we all screw up and mess up and do stupid things and do wrong things. We all have doubts and worries and fears. But the peace that we have is that none of that can shake the fact that we're part of God's family. None of that can take us out of God's family, which is this incredible sense of peace. You can't dig another pit deep enough that God can't bring you back from. You can't walk away far enough that God won't go and get you. We have peace knowing that whenever the world is trying to bury us in with anxiety and worries and circumstances that are difficult and hard, it can't separate us from God. It can't beat God. It keeps us. So work on your peace muscles. Keep going to God, asking for peace, whether that's forgiveness for the things you do wrong, whether that's for hope and comfort when life is just really, really difficult. Keep asking for peace. Just work that muscle again and again. And at the same time, then, as people who have been given peace with God, we should be people who want to bring that peace to others. Jesus said once, "Blessed are the peacemakers." So we want to work on our peacemaking muscles as well. So we're people who try not to hold grudges. We're people who work on being gracious, forgive others, look to restore relationships that are broken, whether that's personal, in terms of community, across lots of different divides. And that's not easy. And often, the gym, I've heard about this, it doesn't happen to me because I don't go to the gym, but you might cramp up. You might get kind of that burn in your muscles when it's really sore and difficult. And that's not easy. And it's important that when we're working those muscles, we're not doing it by ourselves. We have someone who spots us at the gym or someone who does it with us. That's why a church family is really important. Helping us, encouraging us. Have you seen those big kind of cups of protein shakes that all the people who go to the gym go kind of come out, they walk out of the gym with their bags over their shoulders? If you're at Yorkgate or Cityside, you see them coming out of the gym and they've got these massive, really gross looking protein shakes that they're necking down to build up muscles again, to give fuel for that. Well, our peace with God is our protein shake. We keep gulping down reminders that God has made peace with us, and that helps us to make peace with other people. Maybe this Christmas or in the year ahead is a chance to work on your peacemaking muscles in that relationship that's just broken down. Okay, dead simple. Three muscles we've been working on. Gladness muscles, being joyful, let's see your smile again. Yeah. Okay, gratitude muscles, hands in the air. We think about the giver. Going muscles, being people of peace who enjoy peace with God and pursue peace with others, as we think about ourselves as the given as well. Anthony's going to come and pray for us.
Okay, let's pray. Lord, we thank you for your faithfulness and grace over the past 18 months as you work through the vacancy process. We thank you for bringing Liz to our congregation in this period. We're so grateful for her godly influence, helping session, committee, and the congregation as a whole work through the process. Lord, we're also so grateful for bringing Dave back to Ballysillan. We as a congregation are now looking forward to the weeks, months, and years ahead with a confident and secure outlook for how you will use our church to be the light in Ballysillan, sharing the gift of Jesus. We also bring our prayers to the situation at home, where the pandemic still seems to be the main topic in the news, especially with the Omicron variant. We pray once again for our government and those medical professionals who are making decisions on how Northern Ireland moves forward. We pray for wisdom and compassion when making decisions that affect everyone. Lord, with all the busyness around this period, I pray we need not lose the sight of the true meaning of Christmas. We pray that we will make time to thank you for all the things you've done over the Christmas period. We also pray for our carol service this evening that provides us a great opportunity to invite family and friends to reflect on the Christmas story. Lord, we also recognize that there are those who have had a dark and difficult year. Lord, we ask for your love, your peace, and care for these people at this time. We also bring those within our congregation who are awaiting results or procedures, including those in poor health. You know them by name, Lord, and we pray that you will meet them at their point of need in the coming days and weeks. Lord, we bring those to you now who are grieving for friends and loved ones. Be close to them with your love and peace. Lord, we want to spend a few moments bringing our personal prayers to you. Lord, hear our prayers. Thank you, Lord. Lord, we thank you that we can come to you with our prayers, and we ask for your love, your peace, and your comfort for all in need. Amen.
We're going to sing two songs to finish. I had chosen this one not realizing how difficult it was to sing, so just bear with us. And kids, you shake those bells really well, so that they encourage us along and just to give your praise to God. So we're going to sing one that we did a couple of years ago, but I think we used the video for it, which might have helped. But anyway, it's called Oh What a Glorious Night. Just sing along, and then we're going to finish with He Shall Reign Forevermore. So let's stand.
Oh, what a glory.
grab a seat just for a few minutes before the benediction. I said at the very start, I would say something about being since our first Sunday. I just want to say a few little things before we close. First of all, thank you again. I've said it, I know maybe not everyone's in the WhatsApp group. I said it in the WhatsApp group, and I said it on Sunday last, but thank you for your welcome to us as a family back here. Thank you for our home. We're loving just being here and loving just being able to walk to church. It's really nice. But thank you so much for all the work and time and money that went into that house that has made it our home. We're looking forward to getting to know you better. So you should have my phone number if you don't see me. My email, dave@ballysillan.org. You know where the manse is. Feel free to knock the door anytime. We'd love to have a chat with you about life and faith over the coming weeks and months and years. Plan us to be praying for you. At Knock, we did this thing where we kind of took a number of people every week and prayed through them, try to get in contact with people asking for prayer points. If you get an email or a phone call from me, again, don't feel under any pressure to divulge your deepest, darkest secrets. Not right now, but if you want to, you're more than welcome to. We'd love to pray for you, be in touch as the months go on. We'll get around to seeing all of you at some point, probably not before Christmas, especially with all the pressures on around who you have in your house. And to be honest, some of you probably don't really want me in your house this week because I might ruin Christmas on you, just in case something gets passed on or whatever. This week, all I'm going to try and call with folks who had bereavements in the past year because Christmas might just be a little bit tougher for this year. So I'm going to try and call with folks either on the phone or just at the door or whatever. So trying to get through Doreen's phone call list of folks who can't get out to church on a Sunday and try and get in touch with them before Christmas. Hopefully we'll see you later this evening. This evening, carol service, a little bit more reflective. Maybe not so much shaking bells, but just this year has been maybe difficult for lots of you in lots of different ways. Just going to take a little bit of time, just in the stillness, to reflect on that and think about the hope that we can find in that. Maybe see you at Christmas Day or on Boxing Day. But yeah, we're here for a while, so we will look forward to getting to know you. So benediction, talk about benediction not as an ending to a service, but ascending. We're sent out as the people of God. We go with our gladness and with our gratitude, with our peace. So can I invite you to stand, and I'll pronounce the benediction or the sending, which is a blessing just spoken as we go. So may you remember what Christmas is all about. May you marvel at the marvelous things that God has done. May you receive the good gift of Jesus in all his fullness, forgiveness, family, fearlessness, and may the grace of Jesus be with your spirit. Amen. For the kids, there is a gift this morning, okay? So up at the front here, there are very kindly some selection boxes that Anita has got for you. So if you're in primary school, feel free to come and grab one. Lynn, just because you work in a primary school doesn't count. If you're a pupil in a primary school, you can get it. Julie's there. She'll sort you out with them. I'll pop my head outside and chat to you as you come out, and then I'll see the elders in a few minutes. So, okay. Have a good week, and happy Christmas if I don't see you guys.